Yeah, we'll use you for a test.
Good afternoon. Before we start the lecture for today, I have to make an announcement and give you a handout. Every year we have a Holocaust commemorative which remembers the death of the 6 million in the Holocaust. It's held on a Sunday afternoon here at Sonoma State, and this year is just the same as the others. It will be on Sunday afternoon, the 10th of April, at 2:30 in the afternoon. It's an excellent program. It's very inspiring and very uplifting. It's not a sad occasion, even though it commemorates a sad event. It's a series of sad events. This year is a woman who is a very warm and dynamic speaker who is
a survivor of 7 concentration camps. Almost boggles the mind to realize that. Her name is Gloria Lyon, and I would urge you, if at all possible, that you come to that lecture, or it isn't a lecture, it's really a meeting. There'll be music, and there'll be speeches, but mostly warm participation on the part of the audience, as well as the people in the program. I'll pass out these little flyers, and you can keep those as a reminder.
Science for the study of the Holocaust, and particularly the Center for the Study of the Holocaust. I welcome you to the lecture series. Next week, we're going to have a panel of ghetto survivors and partisan survivors talk about their experience. This week, we are very privileged to have a scholar, Dr. Peter Hoffman, who has written a book, The German Resistance, The History of the German Resistance, 1933 to 1945. He holds the chair in German history at McGill University. The subject he's going to talk about, the very nature of it, has not been able to be discussed until years. If this information was discussed during the war, a lot of people would have died some very horrible deaths. If it was discussed after the war, a lot of politicians on the West side, our side, and a lot of generals would have been highly embarrassed, almost to the treason. You will hear things, definitely documented information that has come from the FDR Library, British Archives, German Archives, which will tell you that it didn't have to happen. If we had acted on the information, it didn't have to happen. Back is 1937. Dr. Hoffman was born in Germany in 1930 and has had his education here in America and in Europe. And has written a very, very scholarly account. There's still a lot of questions. Things like the Vatican archives, many of us here will never see that information because it's open for another 50 to 100 years. So there's a lot of information that's still hidden. So let's see, where's Dr. Hoffman is here. I brought him from the airport, so I know he's here. He's with Dr. Steiner, and he will be here shortly. Okay. At this lecture, we're not going to have a discussion period. We want to get as much mileage out of Dr. Hoffman as we can. He's come late. And so there'll be no breakup into discussions. There'll be questions and answers. So. In a few minutes, we will start as soon as he arrives. I'm going to chase him down.
Dr. Steiner going to be rescheduled? And if so, when?
I don't know. The lecture that we heard was his lecture.
I take it the introduction is over.
Yeah, yeah. Let's get you.
Just arrived from Canada, and therefore he needed to get a little bit of exercise, and we just came with the exercise. So that his mind is more stimulated and his blood is flowing. Brain flowing.
I came from New York, and it's, I don't know what, 3 hours, 3.5 hours from New York to Denver. And it's another 2.5 hours from Denver. One stays in Denver for 1 hour and 15 minutes. And that's just a very long time to be more or less sedentary. This doesn't work. This doesn't have the proper loop, I think. No, I don't know how to use it. That's it. Here we are. Louder? Oh, I see, yes. Mm-hmm. Well, as I get into the material, I may get a little louder, but I always begin a little softly. And if you can't hear me, please make a sign of some sort. My topic is the German resistance to the Nazi regime. There is a certain amount of literature available on this topic. There is a great amount of primary source material published, and an even greater amount of secondary source material. But the primary source material is usually of better quality and more advisable for use and for getting a direct impression of what went on than most of the secondary material. You will find a fairly full coverage of what is available in printed form in two bibliographies. One was published by a woman named Laska, and the other by a gentleman named Cartarius. And you will find both of these bibliographies at the beginning of my bibliography in my new book on the resistance, so that if you miss this here, you can look it up. There are some important supporting, from my point of view, supporting works by Raoul Hilberg, particularly The Destruction of the European Jews. That is still unsurpassed, despite all the other works that have been published. Subject, since Hilberg published his book, he published an updated version, not very much updated. You can still use the paperback with almost the same profit, because the new edition is, I think, if I misquoted, please correct me, I think it's $158 US. I distinguish between US because Canadian is always a little cheaper. There is a very interesting, very useful book by Sarah Gordon, The Germans, Hitler, the Germans, and the Jews. I think that's how the title goes. She looked into general population responses to persecution, and she did this with some surprising results. These may also be of interest, but perhaps you are already familiar with them. No doubt you are being told about all these things. You are also, through your lecture series, and please again let me know if I assume too much, if there is something too vague and nebulous in what I say. But I assume that you are familiar with the background to today's topic, the First World War, Versailles, Hitler's rise to power, and so forth. You may be presumed, I hope, to know what it was that provoked resistance. I propose to talk about three partial topics, or segments, if you like. Firstly, the formation of the resistance. Secondly, early phases. Thirdly, a method for a coup d'etat during a world war. And finally, I propose to attempt some conclusions. It is important to keep in mind, first of all, when considering possibilities of resistance, the origin of resistance to a dictatorship, that Hitler never received more than 38% of the popular vote in free elections. Never over 38% in free elections. At least 62%, in other words, always voted against the Nazi Party in one way, simply by voting for other parties. Even on the 5th of March 1933, after more than 4 weeks of terror and dictatorship, or an inchoate dictatorship, a dictatorship in the process of establishment, the Nazi Party remained under 50% of the popular vote. These are basic facts that one must recognize. Gradually, Hitler won more support through successes, through glamour, by simply by being the government. The government, the incumbent government, always has more support than a prospective government, by suppressing the opposition. The opposition that was there in the first weeks and months of 1933 was a carryover, for the most part, from pre-dictatorship years. And this was gradually outlawed. It was just the momentum of party politics still going for a few weeks and, in some cases, months. Gradually, it was repressed, oppressed, outlawed. Political parties, to all intents and purposes, were forbidden by the 5th of July. Political parties other than the NSDAP, or Nazi Party. On the 5th of July, the last of the surviving parties, the Center Party, dissolved itself. So from then on, there were no competitors. Another fact that should be kept in mind in assessing what went on is that 3 million Germans spent time in camps. I'm not saying 3 million Germans were in camps all the time. I say 3 million Germans spent time in camps between 1933 and 1945. Some of them 12 years, some of them a day, some of them a few weeks, months and years. 3 million Germans were in concentration camps at one time or another. Tens of thousands were executed by the judicial system alone. So if you ask, where was the resistance? Why didn't it show its head? Here's an answer. Some opposition then went underground. There was almost no political opposition to the DAP that went underground immediately. On the 30th of January 1933, there was only one organization that was prepared to go underground, and it preferred subversive methods for a number of reasons, not necessarily in expectation of the dictatorship, but this was a Leninist organization that tried to subvert the socialist movement from inside and make it a Leninist movement. It is known as New Beginning or Neubeginnen, a small organization that survived a few waves of arrests, but by 1938 had also disappeared. It was very popular because it managed to publish a pamphlet called Neubeginnen, which was printed in Prague and distributed widely, not only in Germany, but in the rest of Europe. And it was a very well-known group because of this pamphlet. Some opposition went underground, but it was gradually eliminated through arrests. This goes for the communist cells that were formed, for some socialist cells that were formed. eliminated through arrests, camps, secret police work, ruthless persecution, propaganda, and rendered ineffective on a larger scale. But still, although the Nazi government was fairly successful in dealing with potential subversions, potential enemies, Hitler always regarded his position as insecure and gambled. He was a born gambler, and he continued gambling, but he gambled in fear. Compare, for an illustration, his instructions to Speer, to Albert Speer, for the construction of the monumental new chancellery. It was to be built as a fortress with steel doors and so forth, and Hitler explained to Speer that the chancellery must be defensible in case he has to take unpopular measures. So he foresaw, in other words, he foresaw large-scale rioting in front of the chancellery, an attempt to storm the chancellery. He wanted the chancellery to be a fortress that he could defend. He was always thinking in these terms. The Alpine fortress is an instance of this sort of mentality, siege mentality. And fear. The churches were always treated as an enemy force. Thousands of priests and ministers were jailed and thrown into camps. But a final reckoning was postponed until after the war. During the war, Hitler several times said expressly that he could not afford to take on the churches at this point. The confessing church, which opposed the Nazi-dominated established Protestant Church, was suppressed as an organization, but most members and ministers were left alone. For example, Bishop Galen, famous for his sermons against the euthanasia program and credited together with some other clergymen, also some Protestant clergymen, with stopping the euthanasia program. This is not true. The euthanasia program was never stopped. Most of the victims had already been killed in the first place, and in the second place, it was simply carried on in the concentration camps in a clandestine manner, rather than in the relatively open manner in which it had been carried on before, but it wasn't stopped. Nevertheless, he was allowed to speak his mind, and then there was this announcement that the euthanasia program was stopped in August of 1941, and he had no more to say, naturally. But he could continue preaching. Equally, Bishop Wurm, a Lutheran bishop of Württemberg, attacked the racial policies and the persecutions, and he was not harmed. He was arrested a few times, he was reprimanded and so on, but he was not thrown into concentration camp. This was something that could be put off until after the war. Opposition at a high level, with a hope of changing the government, however, was evoked by Hitler's war preparations and by the persecutions. It was clear that Hitler was preparing for war from the beginning. He intended to start the war, and he termed it in advance revolutionary. Revolutionary meaning not an ordinary war for a certain correction of stipulations of the Treaty of Versailles, certain revisions, or even certain limited conquests, but it was to be revolutionary, that is to say unlimited. It would use revolutionary, unheard of methods. And one had pretty far to use unheard of methods and to be revolutionary in comparison with the First World War, which had been quite a large undertaking. It is true that the nature of Hitler's intentions was not immediately clear to everyone, namely conquest and Germanization in the East, and ultimately much beyond. In 1942, he talked about India. He tried to Stalingrad was under siege, and, well, just a rough sketch to give you some idea of the craziness of this. This is Stalingrad, Don, the river Don, and Army Group Don under Manstein. Manstein was appointed to the Command Group Don in November of 1942, just as Stalingrad was threatened, and as the Sixth Army in Stalingrad was coming into a very difficult situation. The name Army Group Don was given to indicate that this territory would never be given up. Later, as soon as it was given up, the name was changed to Army Group South. And down here we have Army Group A in the Caucasus. And this under Kleist. And this army group was supposed to prepare the road, to open the road to India, through Afghanistan to India. Now, it was clear that the Sixth Army was in danger and would be lost if it wasn't supported. It could be supported by Army Group Don. They could road, but then they would engage themselves so heavily that the Russians could come right through here to Rostov and destroy the entire southern front. So that this could not be done unless Army Group A was also retracted. And of course, the Sixth Army had to be taken out of Stalingrad. Hitler refused, absolutely. He rather sacrificed an army of 200,000 men than give up this pet idea. That obviously was not apparent in 1933. That was not clear to most people. A few people, visionary people, as it turns out in hindsight. It's always easy to say he was right in hindsight. But a few saw it, a few said this is what he's going to do, but nobody thought it possible. That's revolutionary. The second point, and it's really not separable from the Eastern War, is of the Jews. The psychological mystery of the coherence between these two programs may never be revealed, but the facts are certainly observable. Opposition to war and persecution raised its head on two levels, on the grassroots level and on a high level, or an establishment or government level. The common people obeyed in the end, most of them did. Those who didn't were in camps, or many of them had been killed or forced to emigrate or found themselves forced to emigrate. And to be sure, there were exceptions. There were still exceptions during the entire course of the regime, but exceptions to obedience. Although both Hitler and Roosevelt found they had to mount monumental propaganda efforts to get to support the war. And again, I'd like to point out to you that both these heads of state had the same difficulty. I'm not saying they were the same kinds of regime, etc., but the people were as reluctant in both countries to go to war, to support a war. The government-level conspirators carried on throughout the war, but their great problem was access to power, that is to say, military forces. No government in the 20th century was overthrown by coup d'etat as long as it commanded the loyalty of its army. That was essential to turn the army against the government, or at least a part of the army. A sufficient part of the army was all that was needed. Access to instruments of power was available at a high level only, if at all. It's a striking fact that many leading persons within the government establishment conspired against the government, that they did so in time of war, that they thus transcended nationalism. The explanation is precisely Hitler's meaning of revolution, which dawned on people gradually, namely a cynical, nihilistic attempt to form a great German empire, to rule the world, to murder entire population, to risk will and promote the destruction of the very people, the very nation, who sacrificed their own lives for Hitler's power. The fundamental and comprehensive evil evoked a resistance on equally fundamental grounds. Small though it was in numbers. Two themes have been touched now. Firstly, the political social concepts among the resistance, what they wanted is of a Hitler government, and secondly, the perennial efforts of the conspirators to win military support. Firstly, as to concepts, they spanned the political spectrum from left to right entirely. Collaboration with the communists was attempted. It was approached with caution. The resistance, of course, did not want to exchange the brown dictator for a red one. But in June 1944, coordination was attempted. It failed immediately because of foreseeable and predictable problems with the communists. They were infiltrated by the Gestapo, and the meeting was betrayed. And at the second meeting, all participants were arrested. This was the chief difficulty in dealing with the German communists. The principles of political liberty, individual liberties, justice, law, human dignity were shared by all, and I must accept the communists because they did not want political liberty, but to the extent that individual liberty was concerned or human dignity, it's a matter of different conceptions. All sought to avoid repeating the mistakes of the Republic, and again, except the communists, they saw, of course, the mistakes of the Republic, the Weimar Republic, in quite a different light than everybody else. They thought there should have been no social democratic party, and there should only have been a communist party, and it should have been in power. That's the only mistake that, very, very crudely put, the only mistake that they could see. But there were serious constitutional and institutional weaknesses in the Republic that were now recognized because they had, of course, enabled Hitler to come to power. And one of the most important was the electoral system, which diffused the political will of the voters impossibly so that it could not really crystallize. The proportional electoral system was a very great weakness. Political education, the powers of the president, as opposed to the powers of the chancellor, was a problem, and rapidly changing governments. The Federal Republic of Germany, that's West Germany, has written into its constitution a clause that says that whenever the parliament, Bundestag, wants to topple the government, it has to replace it at the same time. In other words, they call this a construct of no confidence. In other words, they have to agree on a new chancellor before they overthrow an old one. They cannot just overthrow a chancellor and then let things slide. This is one of the lessons that were learned from the constitution of the Weimar Republic. All in the resistance recognized there were such weaknesses and they wanted changes. All, and I repeat, all were shocked by the treatment of the Jews. Sarah Gordon has gathered information from Gestapo records to show that this was so. The policy of persecution was successful because of because of isolation. The Jews were isolated, but of course, this was an isolation that was taken in steps, in small steps. I don't intend to defend the position of populations like the Berlin population in letting this happen. In small towns, it's a different matter. Very small towns, a different matter again. And sociologists like Dr. Steiner can probably tell you much more about this than I could. But in any case, the treatment of the Jews became worse progressively, and the shock and the revulsion among the resistance increased proportionately. All wanted a solution of the problem. Now, some have been attacked for even talking about the solution of a problem, and of course, as you probably know, there are all shades of opinions about these matters. As long as the Jewish people consider themselves a separate culture or an individual culture, as long as allied countries, or future allied countries like the United States or Britain or France or Switzerland, well, Switzerland was not an allied country, or Canada, refused to admit Jews in large numbers, there is a problem. And there is a problem that needs a solution, or there was a problem, at least, at the time that needed a solution. You probably know the difficulties that President Roosevelt got into when he wanted 1,000 Jews from countries admitted to America to stay in a camp for the duration of the war and then to emigrate to some other countries. There was such an uproar in the Congress about this that it had to be abandoned. The scheme had to be abandoned. It could not be done. The immigration quota of 75,000 under the Palestine policy of Great Britain was never exhausted. In October 1944, there were 14,000 still not taken in that five-year program, which began in 1939. There's no good explanation for that. Although, of course, in reality, far more than 75,000 had already made it to Palestine through illegal immigration and so on. But you see that there is a problem, that there was a problem. There were realists and traditionalists. Some were in favor of integration, and some were in integration. There were liberal intellectuals who advocated Marx's solution, a very simple solution. The problem will go away when we do away with religion. Abolish religion and you don't have a Jewish problem, or any related problem. First of all, however, and on this all were agreed, end the persecutions. An end to the persecutions was the first business. Secondly, a theme that has been touched on was military involvement in the resistance. A crucial issue. Nothing could happen without it. And this brings me to my second part, early phases. Foremost among the military men involved in resistance to Hitler was the chief of the general staff of the army, Ludwig Beck. He began by objecting to the speed of rearmament in 1933. He objected and refused to draft plans for an occupation of Austria. He actually refused to draft plans and didn't draft them. When Hitler called him on the 10th of March, 1938, well, Hitler told Keitel, get Beck, have him bring the plans. Keitel said, well, he won't have any, or something to that effect. And anyway, Beck was summoned to the Reich Chancellery, and Hitler said, what are the plans? And Beck said, I didn't make any. And Hitler said in this rather violent interview, between one on the 10th of March, 1938, I'm going to send the SS to occupy Austria. Well, he probably also told Beck that there was no problem of foreign intervention and that there would be no war, and that in fact the Austrian government was asking for military aid, the Austrian government having been changed in favor of the Nazis with the Seyss-Inquart and his elevation to security minister, I think it was called. And nobody had any real objections to the union with Austria. The objection was violent methods and so on. In any case, Beck went along. This is another story, and I shouldn't get into it because it's a difficult one, and we really don't know the answer. We really what Beck's thinking exactly was on this point, except that he certainly agreed with the union with Austria, but did not agree with the means that Hitler proposed. So there was no plan Otto that Beck had worked out. He had also refused to make plans against Czechoslovakia for an intervention against Czechoslovakia. He had insisted that, now you must know that France and Czechoslovakia had an alliance, a military alliance. And in case of a conflict between Germany and France, Czechoslovakia was obliged to come to the aid of France, that is to say, attack Germany. In case of a conflict between Czechoslovakia and Germany, France was obliged to come to the aid of Czechoslovakia, that is to say, attack Germany. How a conflict starts is not the military concern. The military concern is how to meet a contingency. A chief of the general staff has to make plans for a contingency. Now, Beck insisted that an intervention against Czechoslovakia could be considered only as an aid in a conflict with France. And then, of course, it had to be considered, but under no other circumstances. And he objected to any other plans that Hitler might have. And, of course, Hitler had precisely other plans. Hitler wanted to isolate Czechoslovakia and beat Czechoslovakia and occupy it before France could make a move, banking on the French reluctance to get involved in a war. Beck also fought Hitler's policies to browbeat and isolate and eventually attack Czechoslovakia after his objections had been overruled. Now, I must say a word or two about a very important event on the 5th of November 1937. On this day, Hitler spoke before a number of high-level government persons in the Reich Chancellery. He had gathered the foreign minister, the war minister, the commander-in-chief of the army, commander-in-chief of the navy, and the commander-in-chief of the Air Force. The foreign minister was Konstantin von Neurath. The war minister was Field Marshal von Blomberg. Commander-in-chief of the army was General von Fritsch, Colonel General to be exact. The commander-in-chief of the navy was Grand Admiral Raeder. The commander-in-chief of the Air Force was General Göring. And he outlined to them his plans for the future, his military foreign policy plans for the future, saying that one might first take over Czechoslovakia and then Austria, or possibly vice versa, depending on relations between France and Italy, and whether perhaps France had no government at a certain point in time, then one might make such a move, and so on and so forth. In short, he outlined plans for military adventures and for military conquests. Three of those objected. None of those present supported Hitler in what he said. No one said, this is what we should do. I agree, this is a good policy, or this is in the logic of the political situation. Nothing. No one supported what Hitler said. Now, in a situation like that, a chief of government has to resign in most normal countries. but of course not Hitler. A very extraordinary situation, and especially in a dictatorship. The three who had objected were out by February 1938. I should perhaps say that four objected. The three were the foreign minister, the war minister, and the commander-in-chief of the army. Commander-in-chief of the Air Force also objected. Göring also objected. But he was not kicked out. I suppose that would have much of a risk. He was very popular, but he was not given the posts that he wanted. He wanted to be war minister or commander-in-chief of the army. He was given neither post, so that he too was reprimanded. The successor of the commander-in-chief of the army was bribed by Hitler. And I mean bribed with money. I shouldn't go into this here, but if you're interested, perhaps we can deal with that later. Brauchitsch was the name. And now, of course, plans for conquest went forward. Beck was the solitary voice who campaigned against these plans and ultimately tried to launch a coup d'etat in July and August 1938. He tried to bring about a conflict by asking the commander-in-chief, Brauchitsch, to ask the commanding generals to say no to Hitler's plans, to say, if you insist on carrying out these plans, we resign. Well, in a dictatorship, this is impossible. This is impossible in any kind of circumstances, that all commanding generals say, we resign. That's a coup d'etat. If that happens. So that it couldn't be tolerated. It couldn't be tolerated by Hitler, as Manstein explained in Nuremberg. A dictator cannot allow himself to be forced, or his dictatorship is finished. Brauchitsch did not support Beck in this venture, and consequently, the other generals, and in the army, you know, there are very strong principles of hierarchy and of chain of command. The other generals consequently didn't support him. About two or three spoke in favor of what he wanted, but that was all. So he had no choice but resign. At this point, when Hitler had just survived a very dangerous conspiracy, and he realized that there had been a conspiracy, and he realized that he had to head it off at the beginning of August, and he did, by calling another conference and so on, details to be spared you. Now he realized that the general population was found lacking in enthusiasm. On the 27th of September 1938, at the height of the Sudeten crisis, when everybody was talking about whether there would be war or not, and when Neville Chamberlain was flying back and forth between Germany and Britain to defuse the situation, the 2nd Motorized Division from Stettin was marched through Berlin, through the streets of Berlin, at an hour when everybody was let out of offices and factories and so on, about 5 o'clock, and nobody cheered. Everybody turned away, people ducked into the underground, and some who watched were critical. We have several witnesses for this. One of the best is William L. Shire, who cannot be accused of pro-German bias by any stretch of the imagination. In his Berlin diary, he described this scene and concluded they were dead set against war. On the 10th of November 1938, when the synagogues were still smoking and some of them still burning, Hitler paid no attention whatever to the synagogues. He spoke to a gathering of newspapermen. He never mentioned the synagogues. He never mentioned the events of the 9th of November, the pogrom, never mentioned them. He talked about war and about the reluctance of the population to support a war and to be ready for a war. He said, and I quote, "Circumstances have forced me to speak almost only of peace for decades. Somehow I believe that this record, the pacifist record, has played itself out here. Now we must prepare the German people for war. They are not ready. They don't want war. I cannot have a war with such a people, with such cowards," or whatever he called them, "ready." And the propaganda efforts were doubled, redoubled. One must never underestimate the effect of propaganda, especially when one asks oneself, why do I buy this product? Or why do I buy that product when I need neither? Propaganda can be effective. It isn't always, but it can be very effective. Meanwhile, there were individual acts of resistance which were evoked by persecution, by the persecution that was going on, by the danger of war that was apparent. A Swiss theology student by the name of Maurice Bavo, a South German cabinet maker by the name of Georg Elser, organized and or planned in 1938 and 1939 assassination attempts against Hitler. Maurice Bavo tried to assassinate Hitler in November of 1938. At the very same time, Georg Elser was doing a bit of reconnaissance on the terrain that he planned to use, namely the Bürgerbräu Keller in Munich, where an annual commemorative ceremony was held, at which Hitler was usually present. And there he set off his infernal machine in November of 1939, which almost didn't kill him, because he wanted to catch a train. He wanted to be back in Berlin the next morning, and it was impossible to guarantee a flight out of Munich, because November is very foggy, and usually the airfield is fogged in until noon, and therefore Hitler decided that he would take a special train, and the special train had specified runs. You couldn't have a special train just any time you wanted. You could, but then it took 15 hours to Berlin, because it had to let freight trains bypass and so on and so forth, had to stop many times if it was an unscheduled run. If it was a scheduled run, then it could be run at a decent time, but then also one had to leave on time. One had to leave at a specified time. He wasn't there when the bomb exploded, at a time when he usually would have been there. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was appalled and shocked by the pogrom when he heard about it in his isolated seminary in Finkenwalde on the 10th of November. And he prayed with his students the words of Psalm 74, "Thy foes have roared in the midst of thy holy place. They set up their own signs for signs. They set thy sanctuary on fire. To the ground they desecrated the dwelling place of thy name. They burned all the meeting places of God in the land. Arise, O God, plead thy cause." Curious that the Pope in June of 1520 should have used the same words as the beginning of a bull against the errors of Martin Luther. "Exsurge Domine et judica causa tuam" are these words, but that's just as an aside. Please cut that out of the tape. Later in the war, the Red Orchestra group was active, and again, you could say this was on a semi-popular level. The Red Orchestra group was the war organization of the Soviet Intelligence Service. An intelligence service in a foreign country always has at least two organizations, a peace organization and a war organization. The peace organization operates in peacetime, and the war organization is set up to go into operation if a war breaks out, because you have to have an organization ready when there is a war that you can use, that isn't by chance eliminated. And if the peace organization is decimated or eliminated or made ineffective, you have to have a fallback position. And that's the war organization. That's the Red Orchestra group, which began operating only in June of 1941, after the attack of Germany on the Soviet Union, and was soon decimated. It was fairly effective for a few months, but by the end of 1942, it was effectively destroyed. The Hans and Sophie Scholl group should also be mentioned, a group of Munich students with a philosophy teacher, a philosophy professor, who in February of 1940, on the point of being discovered, went public and dropped leaflets on a large scale in the University of Munich and were subsequently all executed. They had called for resistance, for an uprising against Hitler, a popular uprising against Hitler, unsuccessfully, needless to say. The assassination attacks, which came to the attention of the authorities, of course, led to vastly increased security measures and made future operations of this kind more difficult. But all these brave actions that I've mentioned so far were no more than irritants to the regime. They could not impair the functioning of the regime significantly. And once unleashed, the furies of war did not greatly disappoint Hitler. Again, there was hope only in high-level action. After Beck's failure, and now I return to this high-level action, after Beck's failure, his successor, General Halder, tried in the fall of 1938, with apparent resolve, we have to give him credit at least for having stuck his neck out. He got deeply involved in treasonous activities, and he risked his life. No matter how effective he would have been in an actual coup situation. But in 1939, he was at most half-hearted, and by November 1939, he gave up. And he told a co-conspirator who tried to press him for action against Hitler. And I quote, this co-conspirator made notes, took down what he remembered Halder as saying, and he was killed at Stalingrad, so we can't ask him if he took notes while he was speaking with Halder, but we can probably take it that it's an accurate record. Halder is said to have said, it violates tradition, that is the coup d'etat or the overthrow of the government by the army. It violates tradition. Secondly, there is no successor. Thirdly, the young officer corps is not reliable. Fourthly, the mood in the interior is not ripe. Fifthly, it really cannot be tolerated that Germany is permanently a people of helots for England. Sixthly, concerning offensive, and that is concerning the offensive against France, the Western offensive, which everybody was afraid of except Hitler. And everybody in the military, of course, had memories of the First World War and trench warfare and so on. And they tried to talk Hitler out of it. Halder said concerning offensive, Ludendorff too in 19 had led the offensive against the advice of everyone, and of course it failed. And the historical judgment was not against him. That's a terrible thing to say. I will do the offensive. If it fails, it fails, but the historical judgment will not be against me. That's a terrible thing to say when you know what an offensive costs in lives. He, Halder, therefore, did not fear the later judgment of history either. The obtuseness of this statement never fails to surprise me whenever I read it. And this was said just as Neville Chamberlain and Lord Halifax were willing, despite the Venlo incident, an incident in which two British agents operating in the Netherlands had been lured into a trap by Schellenberg's SD and had been captured. They had been posing as resistance representatives. That is, the SS had been posing as resistance representatives. And despite that very off-putting incident, Chamberlain and Halifax were still willing to deal with any post-Hitler generals. If generals overthrew Hitler, they were willing to deal with them. Later, he became deeply involved and entangled, at least entangled, I would say involved, in crimes in Russia, which are signified by the terms Commissar Order, the order to shoot all political commissars in the Red Army, shoot them as they are captured. One might mention that 2 million Russian prisoners of war were dead by March 1940. Prisoners of war died after having been taken captive. The total finally reached 3.3 million. This was a deliberate policy of letting them die or killing them. Some were killed outright. Most of them were starved to death or killed through disease and so on. But it was deliberate. 7 million of the civilian population were killed during the campaign. That's unbelievable. And of course, Halder was involved. You're all right. He was out by September 1942, but he was deeply involved until then. And the judgment of history is not against him, as he predicted. At least not the judgment of military historians. I come to my third part for a coup d'etat during a world war. You can see now some of the difficulties that confronted those who wished to overthrow Hitler. After the failure of the efforts of Bert Haldo, conspiratorial activity, shifted from the office of the Chief of the General Staff of the Army to other centers. Firstly, to the Military Counterintelligence, which was an Armed Forces Command office, with Admiral Canaris' support. Admiral Canaris, of course, was in charge of this office, and he supported the activities. The principals were Lieutenant Colonel Oster, Dr. von Donani, von Höfer, and Dr. Josef Müller. Actually, their main underground activity was to aid Jews and to aid hostages and prisoners of war. Moltke was also involved in these activities. In February and March 1943, they organized attacks on Hitler's life, which failed. I shouldn't say this. Everybody knows they're failed. They failed, lived until 1945. In April 1943, arrests destroyed this center. Arrests which were made because the efforts to support Jews were found out. And there was a rivalry between the SD and the military intelligence from the very beginning. As long as there was an SD, Schellenberg's SD over intelligence services, and intelligence services are always rivals. If there are two, there are two rivals. And they were looking for something that they could pin on the military intelligence service and reduce its influence. They were also suspicious, not without reason, of the loyalty of some of the people in the military intelligence. So they were on the lookout for something, and they thought they had something against Donani. They thought they could prove that he had worked for his own on his own account, that he had appropriated money for himself when he was using the money to disguise certain Jews, Berlin Jews, as agents of the Abwehr to get them into Switzerland. And it is incredible, but this was explained to the German border guard when these Jews were put across the border in Basel in 1942. These are undercover agents. They had to have the stamp with a J in the passport because Switzerland had introduced this this requirement. The Swiss wanted to know whom they were receiving, but it was explained to them, this is just a cover. These are undercover agents. The arrests of April 43 then destroyed the centers. Secondly, there was another center of conspiracy in the staff of Army Group Center in Russia after the summer of 1941. It operated in cooperation with the Abwehr group. Thirdly, there were conspirators in Paris around von Stülpnagel, who in 1944 were also supported by Field Marshal Rommel. That's always an interesting story, always good for a question, perhaps later on. Fourthly, there was a group called the Kreisau group around Moltke with connections in the Abwehr, in the civil service, in the foreign service, in the churches. Nine out of 19 were socialists. Fifthly, there was the Stauffenberg group, which only became active in August of 1943 in the Home Army Command, and of course was met its demise in July 44. The Stauffenberg group succeeded the Abwehr group, or the military intelligence group, after its breakup. Stauffenberg was posted to the Home Army after he had recovered from received in Africa. He had lost an eye and a hand and part of the arm, part of the right arm, and a kneecap, and had a number of other injuries. He had moved into the conspiracy gradually in 1942, was then posted to Africa and wounded, and now returned, recovered, and took up the reins of the military conspiracy. A precondition for the coup d'etat, it has been said, was military support. Many efforts were made to win over field marshals. Most of them argued it's too dangerous, could lead to a chaotic collapse. Some of them argued the same way as Halder had. Most believed in an armistice with the fronts stabilized, and then negotiations would have some hope of success. They forgot one thing, which was that no one was going to negotiate with Hitler. As long as Hitler was in power, there would be no negotiations whatsoever. It was necessary to have some expectation of political support after a coup d'etat that overthrew Hitler. The political program could not be attained without internal political support. Such political support and the military support depended on the position or the attitude of the Allies towards the German resistance. A coup with reasonable prospects of success depended on the position of the Allied powers concerning post-war Germany. It depended, in other words, on assurances that post-war Germany would receive different treatment if it overthrew Hitler before the end of the war. But the position was unconditional surrender from 1940 on. The announcement in Casablanca, January 1943, was only an announcement. It was an announcement of a phrase, but the policy was certainly in place by 1940. Churchill wavered only once after becoming prime minister in early in 1940. He wavered only once, and that was on the 27th of May 1940, while the fate of the British Expeditionary Force hung in the balance at Dunkirk. As soon as the transfer, the rescue of the Dunkirk troops was assured, Churchill was hard and never wavered again. Annexations and expulsions were programmed. Annexations against Germany, expulsions of German population segments were programmed by the Hitler-Stalin Pact. As you know, Hitler and Stalin, that Russia was to have roughly the Curzon Line, which was eastern, which turned over eastern Poland to Russia. Russia received a little more. Russia also received the Baltic states and so forth. And Britain had entered the war for the integrity, not the territorial integrity, but the national independence of Poland. The territorial integrity was expressly excluded from the agreement. But still, the national independence of Poland, and it was clear that if the Allies won the war, Poland had to be compensated for the losses to Russia. And such compensation could only come from German territory. East Prussia, Silesia, as the war wore on, these became the territories that Poland was promised, and that the British government agreed, and the American government eventually agreed to turn over to Poland. Now, part of the problem that had arisen in 1938 and 1939 was an irredenta problem, namely the Sudeten Germans, Germans whom Hitler claimed as part of the German nation and who were living outside of Germany. So this could not be allowed again. These populations, German populations, in annexed territories had to be expelled. It was a matter of, as the British estimated, expelling between 3 and 7 million. As it turned out, 14 million were expelled, and 2 million lost their lives in the expulsions. This could not be foreseen. The 14 million perhaps could not be foreseen, but annexations and expulsions could be foreseen to a certain extent and were foreseen by some in the resistance. Now, if this was acted upon, what German national government could say to the German people, we have to accept this. We must overthrow Hitler and accept these conditions. First we overthrow Hitler, then we lose the war, and then we lose part of the country, and then we get the population expelled. And here we are, please support us. That is an impossibility. That is a political impossibility. The attitude, of course, as I said, was uncompromising. Churchill ordered absolute silence as the British replied to all German resistance overtures. The German resistance remained without any outside support, unlike any other resistance movement in Europe. The German resistance had no outside report. And from these conditions that I have now outlined, there evolved the method for a coup d'etat. Firstly, to kill Hitler, to make it possible for army persons to support a coup and to go along with a new government. Secondly, to use the Home Army to take power. The pretense was that the Home Army took over power to thwart the efforts of a clique of party bigwigs trying to stab the fighting front in the back. This, of course, wholly fraudulent, but it shows you how the conspirators assessed the mood of the German population and the mood in the army. They believed they had to resort to this mystification to get any support whatsoever, to get any compliance whatsoever. In 1938, Beck had done the same thing. He had said, of course, there must not be the slightest suggestion of a plot. That was true because it was a plot. There cannot be a suggestion of a plot and then expect the plot to succeed. That's not possible. Also, we must make it clear, said Beck, that our struggle is for the Führer and against the SS and so on. The same sort of mystification, the same sort of position. The question arises, why did conspirators act in the face of this great hopelessness, in the face of the certain defeat, in the face of the certain occupation and probable dismemberment of their country? And the answer is, can be only one, to stop the killing, even if the territorial integrity and independence of the country were destroyed. Not all resistors agreed with this, but many did. Key resistors like Trott or Moltke, they wanted also to document the existence of an anti-Nazi resistance, of anti-Nazi Germans. They wanted to save a remnant of the honor of Germany. They wanted to resist evil under the dictate of their conscience. The organization of the 20th of July 1944 plot reinforces this. Colonel Stauffenberg, the chief of staff of the Home Army, who in June of 1944 became chief of staff of the command of the Home Army, but until then he was chief of staff to a general heading a section. Stauffenberg then was to run the seizure of government power from his Berlin Home Army staff office, hoping to avoid interference from the commander-in-chief, who was not in the plot. He knew of the plot. He didn't try to stop it. He used to say, "We are always on the right side." He obviously planned to be on the right side without committing himself. Stauffenberg himself had no access to Hitler's headquarters until the 20th of June 1944, when he was appointed chief of staff in the Home Army command with access to Hitler's headquarters for certain purposes, such as conferences on on raising units. Excuse me. Since no other would-be assassins succeeded, some tried. Some who had access refused to try, and so forth. Since no others succeeded, Stauffenberg decided to do it himself when he had the chance after the 20th of June 1944. Hitler's headquarters was some 350 miles away from Berlin. At least a 2.5 hour, could be a three hour flight. This led to an absurd position. Stauffenberg, the commander of a military operation, if you want to call it a military operation, the coup operation, had to carry out his own order at the front and then return and lead the coup. Generals cannot lead at the front. If the general is killed, there is no leadership. A lieutenant can be replaced, but not a general. That's too difficult. Generals have to lead from behind the front, even if they don't like to. Stauffenberg, because of this, had to survive the attack. This could certainly impair the chances of the success. The Home Army had to move simultaneously with the assassination. A 2 to 3 hour time gap could not be tolerated. However, how to avoid it? If Stauffenberg's friends in Berlin acted while he was in Hitler's headquarters on a signal that he might be able to give, or that he had some friends in the headquarters that one of his friends could give to Berlin, if they immediately ordered the troops out, then perhaps there was a chance of bridging this gap, avoiding the pitfalls of this gap. But who could give the order? Orders in the military context are given by the commander, by him who has authority to command. This was General Fromm, the commander of the Home Army. In extraordinary circumstances, let's say he was incapacitated or he was out of town and immediate action had to be taken, his deputy was his chief of staff, was Stauffenberg. Who else was there? Fromm was not going to give the order. There was General Olbricht, the head of the section in which Stauffenberg had served before becoming chief of staff, Home Army. He didn't have the authority. He had a little authority. He had enough authority to alert troops, and he had done this on the 15th of July. 1944, when Stauffenberg had also tried, but had not found an opportunity to detonate his bomb in Hitler's headquarters. He had alerted these troops, and the troops were ready to march on a signal, and then the attack didn't come off, and Olbricht quickly went and inspected these troops and pretended that it was just an exercise. But from the commander-in-chief of the Home Army understood what had happened. He had seen right through this. He had been in Hitler's headquarters with Stauffenberg. This was Wolfschanze on the 15th of July. And so he couldn't do anything about it. And so it had been possible for Olbricht to act alone in the absence of the commander. Up to a point. It was just an initial action. It wasn't full action at all. But on the 20th of July, Fromm was not in Hitler's headquarters. He was in Berlin. And there was no way that Olbricht could repeat this performance. That was impossible. Stauffenberg knew this. Stauffenberg also knew that perhaps his friends in Berlin didn't have the same elan, the same drive that he had. There was a bit of reluctance, a bit of stalling, to call a spade, on the part of the conspirators in Berlin. This handicap that I just described was compounded by conditions at the headquarters. And it didn't matter whether the headquarters was in at the Berghof near Salzburg or Wolfschanze near Rastenburg. Hitler was at the Berghof on two previous attempts, on the 6th of July and the 11th of July, and in Wolfschanze or Wolf's Lair at Rastenburg on the 15th and 20th. The difficulty was the same. The distance was about the same. Stauffenberg had to set a time fuse. Remember, he had to escape. He had to survive the attempt. So he had to set a time fuse. Well, you do this. How do you set a time fuse? It has to be silent. You can't have any ticking or anything, you know, or hissing or something. You can't have any sound. So you have to use a chemical fuse. And it looked like this. It was a so-called time pencil. The British called it a time pencil. It was captured material. And it had a vial with acid and a copper casing, thin copper encasing, and a wire went past this and through some cotton here. And there was a compressed spring. The wire held the spring compressed. At the end of the spring, there was a striker pin, and down here, approximately, a detonator cap, and that would set the thing off. So one had to press this this vial to break it and release the acid so that the acid could eat through this wire and release the spring. That had to be done. Now, if you do this not very carefully, you might break the wire. And then, of course, it's all over. You don't have a time fuse. So this is a delicate operation. Stauffenberg had a total of three fingers. For some reason, his aid did not help him very much. They may be religious reasons. We are not quite clear about that. He didn't want to be an assassin. We know that much. But he couldn't help him enough. Perhaps he was too nervous. Stauffenberg had to do it himself. While he was setting this fuse, he was interrupted. And he was interrupted by a sergeant who tried to tell him to hurry because Hitler was waiting, the conference was beginning. This sergeant opened the door and stood there while Stauffenberg and his aide were setting the fuse. Now, if you were doing this and someone was watching you, you would think he sees exactly what I'm doing. But of course, the sergeant didn't see what he was doing, but that was the feeling. And in these anxious moments, Stauffenberg took only half of the explosives that he had brought. He didn't dare to continue the manipulations. Perhaps he believed, and you can only understand this if you've ever been under pressure and very nervous and had to make a split-second decision, and you had to make some decision, right or wrong. And chances are it's the wrong decision. He probably believed at that moment, and now I'm really speculating because no direct evidence, he probably believed at that moment that he had to have fuses for both packages. He had two packages of about a kilogram each of plastic explosive. And if he believed that, then he had to conclude that he hadn't time to set the second fuse, and therefore the second package would be useless. But the detonation speed of this material is so great, and the flash point has such a high temperature, that for practical purposes, they go off at the same time. They are in the same briefcase, and they don't have to have fuses. This must be the point that he missed at that, in that anxious moment. In any case, he went off with only one of these packages in his briefcase, deposited under the table or next to the table, but that doesn't matter. This table business doesn't matter. Someone moved it and so on. That's all subsequent. That's all after the fact that only half the explosive was used. The first half the explosive was used. If the entire amount of explosive had been used, chances were that everybody in the room would have been killed, because that had to be the design. And it was the design, and we have evidence to that effect. We have witnesses to that effect. Everyone in the room had to be killed if you wanted to be sure that you killed Hitler, because you couldn't know where Hitler would be at the moment of the detonation. He might go around the table to look at some other part of the map. Two were killed, two died later, and Hitler escaped with minor lacerations. Not only did Stauffenberg have this problem with the time fuse and his three fingers and so forth, he also had to leave for Berlin. And there was no reasonable hope that he could escape after a detonation of this kind, of the kind that he planned. If the conspirators, and if especially Stauffenberg, acted despite all those problems, they couldn't have acted for tangible gain, unless they were incorrigible gamblers, and there is no evidence that they were gamblers. They must have acted for some other reason, for something intangible, for an ideal. The resistance action can only be understood as self-sacrifice, and this was the meaning of the coup at that point. In earlier periods, 1938, 1942, perhaps, one could still think of saving Germany and so on. In 1944, one could only think of saving the remnants of German honor, of documenting the resistance. When Stauffenberg, against all probability, escaped from Hitler's headquarters and made his way back to Berlin and set the coup in motion, there were a few initial successes. For example, in Paris and in Vienna. In Paris, the entire Gestapo establishment was arrested, and the sandbags at Saint-Cyr were already stacked up, against which the leaders were supposed to be shot. And that was a fully successful operation, but it was useless because it was not supported by successes elsewhere. In Vienna, there was a partially successful operation, but despite these initial successes, the collapse occurred in Berlin after news of Hitler's survival had gotten out, and Stauffenberg and three comrades were shot on the same night. About 200 were hanged. Many of them, including Stauffenberg's brother Berthold, were hanged slowly with thin cords, and Berthold was hanged several times, revived and hanged again. and the hangings were filmed for Hitler. Fourthly, and finally, let me come to a few conclusions, or attempt a few conclusions. In the face of this tragic entanglement of the dictate of conscience, of lack of support, and ultimate failure, one obviously cannot sit over the resistance. Although it was sociologically representative, it was not representative numerically. The feeling that there was far too little resistance is nagging. It is not relieved by many instances of individual heroism. We should have preferred to see widespread opposition, although we know that it can only bring grief, as it did in Poland in 1955 and subsequent years, it did in East Germany in 1953, as it did in Hungary in 1956, or in Czechoslovakia in 1968, and who asks the Russians to resist on a large scale. We note too much cooperation in evil, but if we try to be objective, we note it everywhere. This, of course, is not a justification. This is a sad fact, a human fact. It's true that the concentration camp horrors were little known, that the perpetrators were only a few thousand, perhaps 100,000. I think perhaps, again, Professor Steiner has a better estimate than I have on the basis of the work that he... Many non-Germans were involved in these things. Polish, Romanian, Slovakian, Bulgarian, Hungarian anti-Semitism were factors, and so on and so forth. But in general, the evil nature of the regime was evident early on. We can say all this was not immediately apparent. We can say this was a general environment and all these things. But nevertheless, the evil regime had made itself manifest even before it came into power. Consider the Potempa incident of 1932. Consider the terror in 1933 and the Röhm massacre in 1934. The very few who resisted and gave their lives knew the fundamental evil. They were convinced that they must act against it. Berthold, Stauffenberg's brother, said, "The worst thing is knowing that it cannot succeed and that we must still do it for our children and for our country." And Tresco, who was the chief figure in the Army Group Center conspiracy, said, "The assassination must be attempted at any cost." And he said this in July 1944. "Even should that fail, the attempt to seize power in the capital must be undertaken. We must prove to the world and to future generations that the men of the German resistance movement dare to take the decisive step and to hazard lives upon it. The resistance self-sacrifice has given German society not an alibi, but a moral perspective, a standard, which it must refer to in facing up to its recent history. The conspirators of the 20th of July 1944 were the most visible representatives of the thousands who had stood up against crime and evil. Despair, at least, is tempered of faith in human decency." Thank you.
I'm sure you all have a lot of questions. I would like to take the moderator's privilege to ask just one question, and I will not ask another. This is from Dr. Hoffman's book, which is in the bookstore now. Page 60. General Beck sent this message via Kleist. Yes, okay. "Bring me certain proof that Britain will fight if Czechoslovakia is attacked, and I will make an end to this regime." This is in quotes, Dr. Hoffman. I'd like to know the back, where this, you got this information, and what happened to it?
Yes, well, this is a statement that Beck made before he knew whether he would have support for his coup internally. He believed that he could take along with him the generals, the commanding generals, for confrontation with Hitler, in which they would say no to his war plans. He was still confident that he could do that. After his failure in this, he believed that his successor, Halder, would do the same thing. Oh, you want me to keep this? I thought the formal part was over.
Well, it would be nice to have the questions.
You should still, all right.
Sure. Would you repeat the questions?
Repeat the questions? Well, Dr. Kravis,
okay,
would you like to
repeat
the question?
Okay.
You take this.
You'll have to get it back. We don't.
Yeah.
Okay. The question was, how did you document the statement, and what happened to this message? Who got it?
I don't know every footnote in my book. I have to check.
There you go, right there. Who got the message, and what happened to it? This was 1938, 1937.
Yes, well, Kleist went to London and saw a number of government people and told them that there were of conspirators headed by the chief of the general staff of the army who were willing to overthrow Hitler, provided the British government in this case, and the French government more or less followed the British government. The French government wouldn't do anything rash without British support in this matter. They were not prepared to take on the Germans alone by any means. So it was really dependent on government. And Beck's suggestion was that if the British government took a strong position vis-a-vis Hitler and denied him everything he asked for, everything he demanded. Of course, Hitler was demanding the Sudeten area and was talking about national Germans or Germans who were to be brought back into the fold, etc., etc., when he really wanted an excuse for an attack on Czechoslovakia and wanted to take over all Slovakia. He was very angry when this was spoiled for him. The suggestion was that Britain say no to these demands. And then Hitler would be exposed as a gambler and as one endangering German security, the survival of the German state, etc. And he would be overthrown by these generals. That was the purpose mm-hmm. of this message. Of course, I said Beck was confident that his successor, General Halder, would carry on with the coup and with the coup preparations, as he did indeed up to a point. And Beck himself went into underground opposition immediately by contacting at least one member of the House of Commons, contacting British people. He had a number of contacts, and you must understand, since this is underground work and clandestine and so on, and could be embarrassing to both sides. I mean, it could be equally embarrassing to Britishers who were found out as having conspired with Beck, etc., and so forth. And after the war, of course, no one owned up to having had any contact with Germans of that sort. So we have a problem with documentation in these things. No one contact between Beck and a member of the House of Commons. Beck immediately went to Switzerland and made some of these contacts. He had, in 1937, he had spoken in the presence of a British Secret Service agent, well, in the presence of someone who reported to this British Secret Service agent and had described Hitler's policies as insane and as unsupportable and had described the position of the leadership of the army vis-a-vis these policies. This was in June 1937, a most remarkable performance in Paris that is described by one of Beck's biographers, Nicholas Reynolds, but not in very great detail. The details that this British intelligence person by the name of, group captain, Christie was his name, recorded at the time. Very far-reaching statements by Beck. You know the rest of the story. It couldn't be done.
Right.
I'd like to add something to this. The British were so convinced that Chamberlain is have peace that they were ready to sacrifice Czechoslovakia. I was with the Czech embassy in the Middle East at the time, so I know the inside story. We were ready to fight. We said we are going to fight if the Germans invade. And the British and the French said to us, if you fight, we will bomb. And this is the inside story. This is the truth. They were ready to sacrifice us because they were so convinced that if they do that, there'll be peace in our time.
Well, they
none
were...
None of them read Mein Kampf, obviously. But this was what really happened.
Chamberlain seemed to have believed sincerely that Hitler was a revisionist and that if legitimate demands were satisfied, there would be it.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it should be kept in mind that Britain estimated that it couldn't meet a military challenge at that time. And this was probably a correct estimate. British rearmament had only just begun.
Yeah.
And they had to buy time from their point of view. Of course, it was time bought at the expense of Czechoslovakia, but they bought by time. And this it's double-edged. It's always double-edged. The dominant mood favoring peace and favoring compromise and favoring arrangements and, of course, on the basis of revisions, no more than that, was there, and the realization that one didn't have the means to oppose Hitler's aggressions at that point. But on the 15th of March 1939, it abruptly, overnight, and it was finished. There was no more mood for peace, and Chamberlain was isolated. Chamberlain hadn't abandoned it, but he was isolated in England. There were a few others, of course. There were the Buxton brothers, for example, or there was the Bishop of Chichester, or David Astor, and so forth. There are always people advocating peace. In a free country, you will always have them. And so you had it in England. But overall, the dominant mood was to resist after the 15th of March. And practically overnight.
More questions?
It's not a question, but a statement. If I understood Dr. Hoffman correctly, he said that the German people did not want war. And I heard with my own ears that the German people were asked, do you want butter or do you want cannons? And so the German people want cannons.
Well, we'd have to look into that, obviously. This must be an assembly of people who were asked that. A distinct assembly. It was what?
It was on the radio.
It was on the radio. It was obviously a certain number of Germans who had been gathered for the purpose of a speech and possibly a dialogue. We would have to know who they were and what sort of organization that was. one can always, a dictatorship can always organize a clock. There's nothing to that. One can always organize an assembly which will respond enthusiastically to anything that is said to it. I think we can believe Shire, and we can believe a Nazi publication, the same statement. And this Nazi publication, I can give you details if you're interested, went into a second edition in 1940 and repeated this statement that there was silence, that the second motorized division was greeted with silence when it should have been greeted with enthusiasm and cheers. No people really wants war, you know. Not really. I mean, we have to be realistic. People don't want war. They get a number of people into a frenzy. Anyone can do that. Anyone who has the skill can do that. But generally speaking, no people wants war.
Is that the resistance was not highly competent or intense or a level of commitment. I wonder if you are able to kind of compare this level of resistance both individual and collectively with resistance in other situations. Have you done some observational studies of resistance in other situations that would enable you to sort of comment on the relative level and intensity of the German resistance?
Well, there are obviously...
the question has to do with the level and intensity of the German resistance, which appears on the basis of the lecture, because it's been relatively mild and in some cases incompetent and not highly intense. And I wonder if Dr. Hoffman can compare that German resistance with other resistance efforts and give us some feeling for the relative...
Well, I think I've done that. I've compared the German resistance with the Hungarian resistance, for example, or with the resistance, or the East German resistance, which was put down by Russian tanks. There is your comparison. If you have tanks, if you have force, if you have power to put down the resistance, then you probably can. I have said, if you have the loyalty of the armed forces, you probably have nothing to fear if you are the government. I think that's the long and the short of it, and I think it applies pretty well everywhere.
I have one very short question and in a way also comment. I've discussed the 20th of July event with one, as a matter of fact, more than one SS general during some of my interviews, and his view was that this sort of assassination attempt or assassination should have not been done in a way Stauffenberg had, namely, let's just leave a bomb and under the table or in a room and then depart himself. He should have had the courage to confront Hitler while he had the chance and shoot him. Now, obviously, it's very difficult to shoot someone with three fingers, because that is something which you have to understand that that's all he had, because the other arm was missing.
That's quite right, Dr. Steiner, and that's something that I could add to the my answer to the question of the last gentleman who asked one. I believe one has to see historical events by themselves. One cannot draw generalizations, or at least not very many, from historical events. One cannot draw rules from historical events. Situations are rarely fully comparable. The are never equal in historical situations. And if what we can do is try to understand what went on as historians. I think if we go beyond that as historians, we are guild breakers. We try to do the work of the philosophers or others. the basis of comparison, a fundamental position, must be what is in the human interest, what is essential for human existence. That is something that we must agree on, and that can give us a basis for assessing historical events and assessing human responses to historical situations. But I'm not sure that it is very useful to compare directly and in detail situations in Hungary and Germany, or situations, well, let's say anti-Semitism in Bulgaria and in Germany, or in Slovakia and in Germany, and so on. It doesn't help very much. It doesn't lead us very far. It doesn't help us to compare. America has suffered a tremendous tragedy partly because of such a comparison. It doesn't help to compare Munich and Vietnam. And that was done. It was always cited when the Vietnam War was justified. Such comparisons are dangerous, and the attempt to draw direct lessons, to draw recipes for action from history, is a very questionable exercise.
Paul, I wonder what reason you find for this lack of cohesion in certain German groups. I was thinking, for example, that the officers who were involved, the military officers, they all went to the same school or were trained around the same time and knew each other. And officer cadres tend to know a good deal about each other in every country in the world. And it seems that they all distrusted each other, and this is one of the reasons for their failure. But none of them cooperate 100%. We look at, you know, all these banana republic uprising, it's inevitably some officer corps who all went to the same school and they decide to take over. And so they had the mechanism by which they could assess each other's strengths and weaknesses. And I also wondered that those people who knew each other in political parties in Germany before 1933 didn't reach out and form new bonds after the parties became illegal. After all, Jews didn't stop each other.
Well, some of them did, and some of them, to answer the last part of your question first, some of them kept up contacts. In the case of the socialists, who had stayed in Germany as soon as they were out of concentration camp, which was sometimes only in 1937 and 1938. In the case of the Center Party, I suppose they kept up their cup, but not for the purpose of the resistance. There's a story about Konrad Adenauer, who was asked to support the resistance, to get involved in a coup or something, and he said, well, who's going to do it? Who's going to overthrow Hitler? And it was put to him that some generals were plotting. And his reply is said to have been, did you ever see a general with an honest face? Well, you know, that's a typical in our statement, and not to be taken too seriously. But what I'm saying is that they stayed at home and drank coffee during the war. And of course they wrote to each other and so on, but not about the resistance. But you had another comment or question, and that I'm afraid was a generalization on the office, and I cannot quite go along with it. On the one hand, they trusted each other very much. If one wants to generalize, and I think the percentage, if one wanted to investigate this, the percentage would be above 50 of those who trusted each other, and trusted each other in some cases very stupidly, because they always told the truth and they had been trained to tell the truth and so on. That could backfire very badly, and so on. But I think I can illustrate the situation much better with an example or two than by saying this is an illicit generalization. On the 26th of January, 1943, Stauffenberg, General Feldgiebel, who was commander of Signal Corps, and Major General Schmund, who was chief of armed forces personnel and Hitler's adjutant, visited Field Marshal von Manstein in Zaporozhye, which was the headquarters of Army Group South at the time. I think it was already renamed. And there is only a very scant record of what was said. Manstein, an aide, who was instructed to listen into all conversations that Manstein had, so that he had a little more information if he received orders, or if he received a report from a front commander or something, someone else had heard it and could help him with the record and so on. And this aide had heard the conversations between Manstein and Stauffenberg, and between, presumably, between Schmund and Schmund and Manstein and Manstein. There is every reason to believe that Schmund knew why Stauffenberg wanted to see Manstein. Certainly Feldgiebel knew why Stauffenberg wanted to see Manstein. Stauffenberg wanted to talk Manstein into heading a revolt of the generals, or the field marshals in this case. Schmund was pro-Nazi, he was pro-Hitler, he was a loyal Hitler man, but he never way Stauffenberg or Feldgiebel or anyone. How do you explain that? That doesn't fit into your generalization. Stauffenberg talked to Manstein and tried to convince him that something must be done, that Hitler must be removed from command at least. Manstein made some notes about this conversation, which confirm in part the story of the aide. Manstein, I can go into the reasons in a moment, but Manstein also never gave away a word, never gave away any of the conspirators who approached him. Although he declined, although he said it was dangerous, it was unacceptable for military persons to be insubordinate to the political leadership, he didn't give these people away. He told them no, and then he carried on. This is the reality, and this is the reality that we must try to understand. It is not easy to understand. Beck, of course, said the opposite. Now, Beck had told Manstein in June of 1938 that he was going to resign. Manstein, at the time, had just vacated his position as first quartermaster under Beck. Cooperated closely with Beck, had been his operations chief in effect, and on the 10th of March 1938, Manstein and Beck worked out the plans for the occupation of Austria, which took place on the 12th of March. And Manstein and Beck respected each other very much. They had a correspondence in 1943, end of 42, beginning 43. Beck had written to Manstein to the same effect as Stauffenberg had talked to him, and Manstein replied, and Manstein told his aide, get this letter to Beck, but don't enter the house, don't even go to the house. Get someone else to take it to Beck. And the aide said, well, all right, I'll do that. And Manstein wanted to know whom he was going to use for this errand. And the aide suggested Colonel Oster. Manstein said, what, you know Oster? Well, all right, and what if Oster can't do it, if Oster isn't there? Then I'll ask Canaris. What, you know Canaris too? No, I don't know Canaris, but I think I can persuade him to do this. Manstein was fully informed, in other words.
But Manstein believed the military leadership must be subordinate to the political leadership. Now, Beck said, on the contrary, this is true in a general sense. This is true when it comes to commanders, divisional commanders, and so on. But the highest level of command cannot accept demands from the political leadership that cannot be fulfilled, that cannot be met by the military instrument, that are, as he put it, with the words of Clausewitz, that are against the nature of the military instrument. Such demands must be rejected, must be resisted with all available means. That was Beck's position. And so you see, it is a fundamentally different position from that of Manstein. Manstein could perhaps claim that he was not at the level of Beck, but his intelligence and his opinion of himself and of his intelligence should have told him that he had sufficient standing to take such a position, but he didn't take it. I hope I have approached an answer to your very problematical intervention.
I'd like to perhaps make just one announcement. There is Professor Hoffman's book available up there. Paper cover and exceedingly inexpensive, and you get a lot of material for little money. Second thing, I just wanted to elaborate a little bit in terms of my research and say, yes, there are even SS generals who knew about some of the conspirators who actually came to talk to them about it, and they did not give them away, by the way. And that's a kind of interesting mm-hmm. thing. And some of these people, again, were high SS general officers, and they didn't give them away.
That's, yes. Them. It's the code of ethics that was effective in the officer corps.
That is something one needs to know.
I'd like to say, respond to Dr. Steiner's question about these assassination attempts using the pistol. In Dr. Hoffman's book, there was one. This is a chilling story, really, a psychological story. Yeah. A general and his aide were supposed to go to a conference. The aide had a concealed pistol, and the general, they both tried to subdue Hitler and shoot him. And they would be giving their life. There were a whole room of Nazis. And for some reason, they get to the conference room, right outside the conference door, and all of a sudden, for this meeting, no aides are allowed. So the aide is left outside in the anteroom with concealed pistol, SS types walking all around. What are you doing here? You say. You know, he's getting ready to fall apart. You know, he had to wait through the whole thing, you know. And fortunately for him, he wasn't discovered. Afterwards, they asked him to do it again. He says, are you kidding? He says, you psych yourself for that once in a lifetime. Uh-uh. And this is probably the reason, is a good reason why they figured it has to be something like a bomb, where once it's put into action, the human element's out of it. This was my conclusion anyway.
Very good points, Dr. Kravis. If I may perhaps add to this, what we are dealing with in the German resistance, and I've tried to bring that out, but it is a complex problem and it requires a lot of thought to bring the elements together. What we are dealing with is not a bunch of traitors. It is not a bunch of ordinary criminals or adventurers. What we are dealing with is high-minded people, idealists, people who are shocked by atrocities and who are opposed to violence. Naturally, they even had internal discussions that went on for years about whether to assassinate Hitler or not, whether to begin a reign of justice and human decency with an act of murder, or possibly an entire round of murders.
it was something very hard to stomach. And it is something that, if you think about it, confronts us all at one time or another.